Okay, so we're going to look a bit at reverse chain rule. We've kind of done a little bit of reverse chain rule already, I believe, with the FA plus BX integration. What we're going to do though now is generalize it a little bit to well, a more general case. And there's sort of two categories of function that we're going to be looking at for which we can use something called reverse chain rule. And one of those involves powers of functions, and the other involves a bit of logarithms, or at least the answer to those questions involves logarithms. So, since we're going to be using a bit of logs and logarithms for reverse chain rule, I've just put a question here relating to that. Not necessarily directly related to reverse chain rule, but it is good to be familiar with our logs and their properties. So here's a question for you. We've got four different logarithmic functions plotted, ln of x, ln of 2x, and so on. And you can see them there, graphed. And based off, you don't have to do any calculation, but based off the image, what would you know, from your intuition and from what you can see in the image, what would you conclude about the derivative of those four functions? That's my question. So have a think, look at the image, and see if you can mathematically describe what you're seeing here. Have a think and pause. Okay, so here's what I was trying to get you to think about. And maybe you noticed something else, in which case, just tell me. Might be something interesting else you spotted. But the main conclusion I was going for here is that, well, derivatives refers to the gradient of a function. And therefore, if we look at the gradient of these functions at specific points, although we can't prove it because it's still an image, what you should roughly be able to see is that, let's say, at 2, how steep is that line? How steep is that one? How steep is that one? How steep is that one? It is a bit of an optical illusion sometimes, but actually, they're exactly the same, right? That is the same gradient as that, and as that, and as that. Okay, the spacing between them is irrelevant because when we're talking about derivatives at a point, it just means the gradient, right? It's similar at, say, 4. That gradient is the same as that one, and that one, and that one. Right, and it's the same all the way throughout. So you can draw a vertical line anywhere. Let's do one near the beginning. So let's say this vertical line. Well, that's a bad vertical line. Let's try one more time. Actually, I'll do it along this guideline. So there you've got a vertical line, and then look at the point on every graph at the point where that vertical line crosses. Again, it should be the same gradient. So what we can conclude is that the gradient function, or the derivative of all four of these, should be the same. And indeed it is, and I think we've done this before, but let's just remind ourselves. If you have ln of a constant times x and you want to find its derivative, what you'll first do is split that up into the following: ln of k plus ln of x, using log rules. And because ln of k is a constant, it just has a derivative of zero. So what you end up with is the derivative of ln kx is the same as the derivative of ln x. And in fact, we don't even have to find the derivative. So we know it's 1 over x. Hopefully we know that. But I'll just make a note of that just in case. But we know the derivative is of ln x is 1 over x. But we didn't even need to show that. The point is, by using log rules, we can show that ln of 4x, ln of 3x, and so on are all going to have the same derivative, which is the derivative of ln x. Okay, cool. So that was it. That's what I wanted to just show you guys there. A nice little graphical representation of what is hopefully a logical result. Okay, so to start getting into this inverse, or sorry, reverse chain rule. Let's do a non-reverse chain rule. Let's just use chain rule in the usual direction. And let's use it on this function here. And this is a special sort of case. It's not a random question. There's a reason why we're doing this, which will become apparent in a moment. But let's have a go at it first. What is the derivative of ln of mod of x? Well, we know that the derivative of ln mod x, or ln x, is just 1 over x. We use mod, remember, so that it's true for both positive and negative values. If you don't use mod, then it's just true for positive values. So to cover all cases, we'll put the mod in this time. And if that's the derivative of ln x, then by chain rule, the derivative of ln f of x is going to be 1 over, instead of x, 1 over f of x, but then multiplied by the derivative of the inside. And that inside, in other words, the thing we replaced x with here, is f of x. What's the derivative of f of x? We don't know, because f of x hasn't been defined. It could be anything. So instead, we'll just multiply by f dash of x, which means the derivative of x. Okay, and so what do we end up with? We end up with this. Okay, and this is quite a key result. Ln of a function, the derivative equals this. Let's just do a specific case. For example, if I had this, the derivative of that is going to be 1 over x squared plus 1 multiplied by 2x equals this. Okay, so this is just normal chain rule. Okay, that's the example we got. But the key result is this one, right? So let's remember that, and we're going to make use of it now when we look at reverse chain rule. So this is the first of two possible reverse chain rule types. This is the reverse chain rule for fractions. And let's note in the top right corner again this thing we've just discovered, that ln of f of x has a derivative of f dash of x over f of x. And in fact, I'm just going to tweak that slightly, make it even better and more general. Let's say in general, I'm going to add a constant k on the outside. And then we can also then just put a k here, because constants don't change the derivative when you're multiplying. Okay, so what can I then conclude about the following? What is the integral of k f dash of x all over f of x? Well, it's just going to be equal to k ln mod f of x. So this is the reverse chain rule for fractions. It's being able to find the integral of a fraction with this special property. So obviously most fractional expressions won't work for this. But if you happen to have a fraction where the top is the derivative of the bottom, then you can find the integral, and it's this, right? So an example of this might be, let's make something up. Let's say 5x all over, let's go x squared plus 3, okay? And I want to find the integral of this. Now, here's the thing you need to spot, is that, well, it just so happens the bottom, if I were to make that f of x, so let's make a note here, f of x equals x squared plus 3, then f dash of x will be equal to 2x. Now at the top here, I've got a 5, not a 2. So what I'm going to do is tweak this and make it the following. I'll make it 2/5 times, other way around. Because I'm going to force this to be 2x, and then I'll put 5 over 2 here, and then I'll write this. Okay, now what I have here is exactly the same as what we started with. I just took out a constant from the 5. So that 5 over 2 multiplies with 2 to make 5. But now the fraction is in this nice form where the bottom, if I take the derivative, I get the top, which means I can now write this integral as 5 over 2 ln mod of f of x, which is the x squared plus 3. And that's it. And so we found the integral of this particular fraction. Okay, so this will work as long as the derivative of the bottom is the top, or the derivative of the bottom is a constant multiple of the top. Then you can use this rule. So let's look at a couple of examples. Oh, I must have been like psychically streaming part A. That's almost what we just did, but let's quickly do it. So I suppose this is how I would do it in terms of the actual working. I'd say part A, find this integral, and then I would, as part of my working, just make a note, because in your head you should be able to notice the bottom is the derivative of the top. And you'd say, right, the derivative of x squared plus 1 equals 2x. Okay, so you immediately have 2x, and therefore you can immediately say, well, this is this form. Right? And there you've done A. Okay, cool. So then B, let's take a look at that one. I'll just write it out quickly. And you'd want to find the derivative of the bottom to do your check. So you're going to do a check and say, okay, 3 plus 2 sine x, the derivative of that is 2 cos x. So then you think, okay, that's a bit annoying. It's 2 cos x, not cos x. So what I tend to do is I just modify it in place. I say, well, part B is the same as asking me this. 2 cos x here, and then a half on the outside. And now I can straight away say, okay, so now my final answer is going to be half times the integral of that thing, which we know is ln of 3 plus 2 sine x plus c. Okay, so that's how you tend to do it quickly. Find the derivative of the bottom, and if it's a bit different, then I just tweak the original integral by a constant. And however you tweak it, if you multiply or divide, you do the opposite and put it on the outside of the integral. And then just make sure you keep that at the end as well. Okay, and then now let's look at the second form of reverse chain rule, which is a reverse chain rule for powers rather than fractions. And just to note, the sense in which all of these things are reverse chain rule, effectively, it just means guessing a function, finding its derivative to see if it equals the subject of your integral, and if it doesn't quite match up, you just do some tweaking. That's all a reverse chain rule really is. It's the most sort of, or I should say, it's the least sort of prescribed method of doing integration. Usually in mathematics, you're told, here's the steps, here's what you do, and just follow those steps and you'll get the answer. Reverse chain rule is more about using a bit of intuition and then getting your answer that way and doing a little bit of playing around with the numbers until you get the result you want. But I'll try and formalize it just a little bit. Well, yeah, we'll see how that goes. So let's start off with derivatives first, and let's do the derivative of a function to the power of n. Okay, and we're just going to use our chain rule. So the derivative of this is going to be n times f of x, and then take one from the power. But then we have to multiply by the derivative of this thing we assumed was an x, which is f prime of x. Okay, so that by chain rule is the derivative of any function to the power of n. So then, of course, again, we can reverse this, right? We can say, well, therefore, the integral of this on the right-hand side is the same as, oops, I shouldn't have got rid of that n, is the same as this thing on the left, right, without the derivative sign. Okay, so what it means is if you see this, if you see something that looks like that form, you can integrate it by just immediately writing that. So it's all about now recognizing stuff that looks like it's in this form. And again, that constant n doesn't really matter, because if it wasn't n, if it was 2n or a half, you could tweak it by then putting the appropriate constant here. So really, it's about recognizing a power of a function being multiplied by its own derivative. And if you see that, you can integrate it using a reverse chain rule. Okay? So I've got some actual examples from the book we can look at, so I won't make up my own, but let's take a look at those and hopefully this will become a bit clearer. So let's look at A. And let's just look at this function we have for a moment. 3 cos x sine squared x. So this is actually, what exactly? This is the sine function to a power being multiplied by its own derivative, cos x. And then the 3 doesn't really matter, it could be any number. And we could use a reverse chain rule. So just the fact that I see sine to a power multiplied by cos tells me I can use a reverse chain rule, right? So what we're then going to do as our guess is we're going to differentiate the function to that power, but just raise the power by 1. So we're going to differentiate this. That's our guess for what the integral might be, and see what we get. So in this case, I get, okay, 3 sine x to the power of 2 now. So bring the power down, take it away. Then I multiply by the derivative of sine x, which is cos x. Okay, and in this case, it worked out perfectly. So the 3 was actually the correct number. So if the derivative of sine cubed x is this, again, therefore, the integral of the thing on the right must be sine cubed x, and we've got our answer. Okay, I'll make some space, and then we'll look at the second one. B. So we've got x times x squared plus 5 cubed, okay, and again, it's all about just seeing the pattern. Okay, this thing here, it has a derivative of what? 2x, right? X squared plus 5 has the derivative 2x. So again, we've got a function in brackets to a power being multiplied by its derivative. Almost, except instead of 2x, it's just x. But again, constant multipliers, we can fix that at the end. So as long as the only difference is that constant multiplier, it's fine. So then let's again do our initial guess. So we're going to take that function, x squared plus 5, increase the power by 1, and now we'll find the derivative. So we'll get 4 times x squared plus 5 cubed. Then I multiply by the derivative of x squared plus 5, which is 2x, and I get 8x x squared plus 5 cubed. Okay, so what that means is that I've almost got what I want, except by a factor of 8 this time. So now here I'm going to fix it. I'm going to put an eighth here, so then an eighth here, then an eighth here, and then of course an eighth of 8 just becomes 1, so we have this. And then again I can say, all right, well then the integral of this thing on the right, and I'll just do it everywhere, must be this, and we've got our answer. So the answer is an eighth x squared plus 5 to the 4. Okay, cool. So that's it. That's how you do reverse chain rule for that case. This is the last slide before I let you do some questions to just see if you can knock out the solutions. But I thought I'd just wrap up with just giving a bit of general guidance and I suppose summarizing what we've just seen. So how to spot when you can use reverse chain rule. Here is my sort of rules of thumb or my tips. If you have a fraction where derivative of the bottom is the top, or let's make that more specific, is a oh, is a multiple of the top, then you can use a type of reverse chain rule. Okay, so that is the version where the answer equals K ln mod of what we'll call the bottom. Right, I'm using slightly non-technical terminology here. Obviously, by top I mean numerator, bottom is denominator, but as a rule to remember in your head, that's probably easier. Okay, derivative of the bottom is a multiple of the top, then the answer is something times ln of the bottom. Okay, that's the first case. And then the second case, when will I use reverse chain rule? Because remember, at this point, we're learning about it, all the functions you're given, it's obvious you use reverse chain rule. But when you're out in the wild and you've got integrals coming at you and you don't know how to integrate them, sometimes you'll use reverse chain rule, sometimes you'll use something else. So you'll have to figure out whether it's appropriate or not. So you need to be able to spot these patterns. So the other is a function to any power times the derivative of that function. And then also times a constant is also fine. Okay. At which point, answer is you just have to try and find a derivative. So I just say try derivative of function but plus one to the power. Okay, so that's your first guess. And your first guess will be basically correct as long as you then tweak at the end. Okay, so hopefully that made sense. Let me give you some questions then to try out. In the second part, we'll look at some slightly trickier ones, but just for now, let's see if you can work on the sort of more basic calculation style questions. So I've got two slides. They both look quite similar in the sense that you've got a single question composed of multiple parts. So this is the first question where it's mostly using the log style and see if you can get these answers. And then once you've done this, go on to the second slide and see if you can do the sort of powers of functions style of reverse chain rule. So try these first, you can pause the video now. Okay, and here you've got the second set. And I've noticed towards the bottom it goes back to sort of the log style. So it is a bit of a mixture actually. But give these a go as well. Let me know if you have any problems. Good luck. You can pause now.